আপনারা দেখছেন টকিং পয়েন্ট।
ওয়েলকাম ব্যাক। ব্রেকের আগে আমরা কথা বলছিলাম এমপি রোশনারা আলীর সঙ্গে। We were talking about her job in the constituency, housing, education, unemployment, and many other topics. এখন আমি ওনার কাছে যাচ্ছি, ওনাকে জিজ্ঞেস করব। She is Minister for International Development in She is Shadow Minister for International Development. উনি ওনার জব কি ইনভলভ করে অ্যান্ড MP Rushanara, would you like to say something to our viewers? What does it involve? This is a bit intriguing that you are in the shadow cabinet and yet you are
in opposition.
Minister for International Development and you are in opposition.
Yeah, so in the UK we have a system of shadow government. So you have the government, and the shadow government's job is to question and critique and hold the government of the day to account. So my job is to make sure that I am looking at what decisions the current government's making in the Department for International Development in terms of aid money they're giving to countries, whether it's the right thing to do, whether it's right to cancel aid to countries like India, whether it's right to give government money to the government of Rwanda, which is being accused of financing the rebel movement in Congo that's causing conflict, those sorts of issues. So our job is to hold the government of the day to account in opposition.
Does Bangladesh appear on this list of aid receivers?
Bangladesh is a recipient of British government aid, and certainly in Parliament, often we raise questions related to Bangladesh. Recent ones that my colleagues on the Labour side and I have raised is to make sure that Bangladesh plays its part in relation to, for instance, the situation in Burma. Some of my colleagues have raised that with the Rohingyas who have found themselves fleeing to Bangladesh. Who've been driven out, and also equally they've got very difficult, you know, there are serious issues among the refugees who are in Bangladesh. So there is, of course, there are questions like that that people on my side and other sides, but particularly on the Labour side, have raised. There are many other questions that people will raise in relation to Bangladesh and have done over a number of years, but certainly over recent years.
Well, when you have raised the issue in the Parliament, what happens next?
Well, I'll give you an example. Last week, we asked an urgent question, which means you can call if the Speaker accepts your request, you can demand that the Minister comes and answers your question, which is an immediate one. Last week, it was on why the British government gave money to Rwanda and the situation in Uganda, where the situation in Congo. So the financing of whether UK government money should be stopped to those governments that could be financing the rebel movement that is destabilizing another country. That's a very serious issue because we need to make sure DFID money is used for poverty eradication, for regional politics between countries, so that it doesn't unintentionally end up causing problems. So that's a good example where we will continue to raise those concerns so that if necessary, the British government will have to rethink whether it should be continuing its support to some of those governments.
So it's only in terms of that we will stop the aid?
Well, this is, in the end, it will be a matter for the government of the day to decide. But our job is to identify areas where there might be corruption, where there might be misuse of public funds, and make sure that we put on the record to the government of the day that we have serious concerns about it.
Right.
And as a result of those concerns, in some cases, that can lead to policy U-turns.
I'll give you some examples.
I'll give you some examples. Well, the information comes from a range of sources. It will come from, obviously, news stories on the ground. It will come from the House of Commons Library. If we, you know, there's independent research that will be made available, select committee reports, research institutes, NGOs working on the ground, a whole wide range of sources.
They have to be verified before anybody stands up in the parliament and asks questions about that.
Well, you can. Anyone can ask. Any MP can ask a question. There's a particular format. You have to be on the list, order paper, or it's up to the speaker.
Several people stand up and then sit down.
Yes, and I often do that as well. It's because if you're on, if your name's not on the order paper, that's the business of the day. That's basically like a ballot. It's like a lottery.
You
so I put my name down every week for different departmental questions. And then there's a like a lottery whether my name comes up on the list of the order paper. So if my name's not on the order paper and I want to ask a question, then I need to keep standing up and down so that the speaker knows that I would like to speak. And if he can fit me in, because it has to be politically balanced. There has to be a conservative, a liberal, and a Labour person. So if there are lots of questions listed on the order paper with for one party, then the speaker will make sure that the other parties get a chance to ask a question. So that's why when somebody stands up, he will pick that person, and their name doesn't have to be on the order paper. That's why you see people standing up and down.
But do you, as a shadow cabinet minister, do you take notice of happenings in Bangladesh?
I lead on the Middle East and North Africa and Asia as a shadow minister in the House of Commons. So my job is to make sure that I monitor and my team monitor what's happening in different parts of the world. Of course, Bangladesh is one of those countries, but it's not the only one. I take a close interest because obviously a third of my constituents are from there. I'm originally from there. So I have I have a special interest as a constituency MP. But as a shadow minister, it's one of many countries that I need to make sure that we are looking at closely to see what the British government's doing, what's happening in those countries and so on.
Bangladesh's economy is doing is very well. But the point is, I want to raise it with you, is that the security, the law and order situation is not very happy. Recently, there was a great fire in one of the garment factories. Bangladesh earns about $20 billion every year, see. But those poor garment workers get 21 cents per hour, which is about 10 to 12 p, see, which cannot be compared to somebody working as a manual labor in any part of the world. Well, but that's another story. The working conditions are just like sweatshops. There are nothing else but confinements. The exits are locked from outside so that they don't escape with, supposedly, they will steal goods and things like that. And if there's a fire, the exits are locked and people can't escape. There was recently there was fire, 111 persons died. See. There was another fire.
I saw that.
And since 1990, the days when Bangladesh has gone up as a supplier of manufactured garments, see, there have been 300 fires. See, fortunately, not many people have died. See, but these are time bombs. See, anything big can happen any time, and we supply goods to big names, designers. I mean, I don't want to name them because that will be advertising. See, so American companies, British companies, European companies. See, and we would like, as concerned citizens, see, that concerned human beings, that that the interested parties should exercise some sort of influence. And how can a British Parliament be put into picture?
Well, I let me start by saying how appalled I was to see the fact that so many people had died in the garments factory in Bangladesh. And previously that had happened also in Pakistan. I've been to garments factories, I've visited over the years to see the conditions, and also in the slum areas where women particularly are vulnerable. Many of them are garments workers who live there. And you're right, the backbone of the Bangladeshi economy is the garments industry. And 85% of the people who work there are women. So they face this double threat. They are contributing to the national economy, but they're not getting the protection.
True.
What we did as the Labour Party is when we were in power, we introduced the Ethical Trading Initiative. We made it very, very clear that child labour should not be tolerated. Mm-hmm. But what we wanted to do is make sure that children didn't find themselves in even more danger. Because if you do a blanket ban, that can lead to children True. Ending up in further danger. So gradually changing attitude to domestic servitude and child labour, mm-hmm. but also on those labour rights of people working in industries that are at risk. Keeping the pressure on the companies, Western companies, mm-hmm. through campaigning, through the public being more aware, developing ethical trading initiatives, fair trade initiatives, and so on. But there's a long way to go. And I think that what we need to do is make sure that organizations like the International Labour Organization, mm-hmm. Which the UK government under Labour used to fund, but mm-hmm. this current Conservative government, the first thing they did is scrap that funding. That's because they have an ideological objection to labour rights and human rights, frankly, because it seems ridiculous that
human
they
rights
should.
As well?
Well, I'm saying those kinds of rights, mm-hmm. Because they have a very narrow view of how DFID money should be used. I believe that DFID money should rightly be used to make sure that there is proper support in countries to build people's working rights, mm-hmm. so that they're not vulnerable. They can challenge their employers themselves and organise in a sensible way to change and improve labour conditions. So we need to make sure in the UK that the UK government does have certain conditions to keep the pressure on the government of Bangladesh to improve labour standards. The laws in many of these countries tend to be okay in lots of places, but they're often not enforced.
Well,
enforcement issue.
In book, it's okay.
Exactly. So there are issues of enforcement, which is the responsibility of the government of Bangladesh.
Local government.
Yeah, absolutely. There are issues of the responsibility of businesses, particularly foreign businesses. They need to not only say, look, we're making sure conditions are good, we're paying a decent wage. They need to make sure the middlemen and women pay a decent wage to the people who are working in their factories. So that has to go right through the supply chain. Now, where do the public come in? The British people obviously need to make sure that they keep pressure on their MPs and keep pressure on the current government so that labour standards is not something that is forgotten, because as you've pointed out, it costs lives. And I think that on a subject like this, you know, this is exactly the kind of issue that people in the Pakistani and the Bangladeshi community in Britain should be speaking up about, and should be writing, you know, thousands of letters and sending in requests to the government department and the ministers responsible for Department for International Development, mm-hmm. so that they set place more pressure on those countries to do more, those governments
right.
to do more. But also, you know, we are a major aid donor, so it's important that we use our influence to ensure
True.
That the government plays
True.
Its part, but the businesses, crucially, play their part. And we also need to look at which Western businesses are operating and trading in those factories. And we need to make sure that mm-hmm. they take their responsibilities seriously. We don't want them to stop investing in those countries, but we want them to make sure that people are protected and there are basic labour standards and basic conditions and requirements that are met.
That is the point. I mean, you have hit the nail right on the head, see. The point is labour standards, see. The other day there was a flyover in Chittagong that collapsed, killing
yep.
so many people.
Yeah.
If we don't prepare things with with the right kind of conditions, with the specifications are right, anything is going to collapse, see. And
yeah.
and if it's all systems go, everything goes, then as
yeah.
they say back home, that chalta hai, everything is chalta
yeah.
hai.
Yeah. But I think we need to be clear about the distinction between what is a national matter, which
mm-hmm.
is for the people of Bangladesh to put pressure on their governments and their agencies to act, and what is an international matter. Because, excuse me, although we can apply some pressure, it's going to be resolved on the ground in those countries by the people of that
right.
country. Excuse me.
It's okay. We have another segment to go, so we have a lot of things to discuss. There's another sore issue that I wanted to raise is the overseas workers who suffer a lot and they're not being looked after. They, again, in turn, they have to earn about $13 billion annually for the governments.
Which country are we talking
Bangladesh.
About?
Bangladesh. Okay, viewers, we'll go for a short break and we'll come back. Don't go away. Thank you.
আপনারা দেখছেন টকিং পয়েন্ট।